being here and being here on this month. As you all know or may not know, we relocated to Kentucky, Fort Knox, and we are so glad to be here and seeing what God is doing. And I have to admit, you know, when God said that we were coming here, as we got closer and closer, I was like, God, I know you brought us here, but you're not saying anything. But it wasn't until we got here that he began to reveal his purpose and what he's doing and how he's bringing people into our lives and bringing us into other people's lives to be a blessing. And so I just thank God for to be back, to see you all again. I really did miss y'all, but we were so tired from cleaning and trying to get everything together and, you know, taking a drive. But we are here, and thank you all for your prayers and just being able to know that we can pray for you all as well. So I'm going to go into start with a word of prayer. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for every blessing that you have bestowed upon us. And God, as I release this word, God, I thank you that it is going to fall on good soil, God, not just here right now, Lord God, but even after it is uploaded, that somebody is going to hear this word and they're going to receive it, Lord God, and they're going to respond to this word. And so, God, I thank you for that right now. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I took the topic for tonight, the time is near. But what God gave me was the colon part. And it is, what are you doing with the vision in God's time? So I started at Revelation chapter verse 1, and I'm going to read it from, what is this version? This is the NIV version. So I'm going to start at chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. Because it was just so good. Like, I mean, I was down into the rest of the verses. That's how excited I was. And it says, the revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. I really didn't, you know, didn't fully understand, you know, as I was studying, and some of the things that I just kind of want to share with you, some background, is that near the end of John's life, and this was just apart from the study, he received a vision from Christ, and it records the benefits, you know, of the seven churches in Asia and for Christians throughout history. And I got excited because I said that included us. You know, we talk about history. I'm looking at future history, those that are to come from this time period. We know that John was exiled to an island called Patmos. And I'm just so thankful for John's faithfulness and everything that he did, from the time that he was a disciple to the time that he was appointed to be an apostle by Jesus, and even to write the book, Revelations. And so I have 3 points. What is revealed comes from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. We must testify to what we see. And I like verse 2 because, I mean, in chapter 1, it says he made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies. And so John didn't have to, you know, say, let me try to convince you. But he had the angel who was there to testify, or as a witness to him. And so I'm just thinking, I thank God that we're going to have a witness to the things that God is doing in our lives, to the things that God is revealing, that we're going to have a witness to say, I saw God do it. I saw what God did. They spoke this prophetic word, the vision that they had. I was there when they was crying out to God. And then the third one is, the blessed one is he who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, who hear and take to heart what is written. And I got so excited about this word because I was sharing with Elder Terry, you know, growing up, I kind of felt like when pastors would talk about revelations, like, don't read it and try to go to sleep at night. And one day I took God up on the challenge. I said, God, I really want to read it. I said, because I just can't believe that out of all the books in the Bible, you would put a chapter in here, a book in here, that would cause me to feel like I'm going to die tonight if I read this book, or I'm going to be scared. And I didn't want that fear. And so when I was a teenager, I read all 22 chapters of Revelation. Now, I will admit, I didn't really understand it, but I knew that I wasn't going to allow the fear of Revelations to have a hold on me, even as a teenager. And after I read it, I was excited. I was like, man, this is like a comic book. Like, oh my gosh, we're talking about dragons and, you know, all of these things that are happening, you know, coming, you know, Jesus coming on a horse. And I was like, this is very descriptive. And it was very, very detailed what John saw. And so being an adult now, being mature in the things of God, being mature in my Christian walk, I have an appreciation for the book of Revelation. So I wanted to read Deuteronomy 29 and 29. It said, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may follow of the words of this law. And so I was thinking about, you know, what was revealed, the vision that was revealed to John. And this was God revealing those secret things to him. Why? So that we today in 2023 could know what we need to do to prepare. When life events, the mysteries of God, the word of God is revealed to us, or a vision is released or revealed to us, we really need to thank God, because really what I see in Revelations is that it allowed us to see the character of God. Revelations allowed us to see the heart of God. It allows us to see how much he cares about us, you know, and why he had to send his only son, because it's an opportunity for us to continue to live right, to live righteous lives, to be able to live our purpose for Christ.
Amen.
And so we see John's obedience, because the word testimony used indicates the authentic witness. And that's going back to the angel. When we look at who God blesses, it's important for us to have a passion to read God's words, his promises that he gave us in verse three, is that he's going to bless those who read the words of this prophecy. He promises to bless all who listen and obey it. And so the three themes you hear or that you can glean from this is that we got to read, we got to listen, and we have to obey. And Apostle, you talked about that, being obedient to God, you know, being able to do what he's called us to do, especially with the time that we have. And what is not revealed is when the time is near. We don't know when that time is near. Now, you know, I'll admit, I used to be like, oh my gosh, if I hear one more old person in church tell me that Jesus is coming back, I'm like, they've only been saying 2,000 years forever. He coming back, you know, 2,000 years ago, he died on the cross and he's coming back. And I used to be like, well, Lord, can you do me one favor? Can you not come back until I have done what you've called me to do? I said, because they making it seem like they know when you're coming back, but he doesn't reveal when he's coming back. And so again, that is giving us the opportunity to still experience the blessings of God, to read our word, to listen to the word of God, to listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying to us and how he's leading and guiding us, and to obey, because he says that we will be blessed. God is going to bless us just from doing those things. And so as I was looking at, what are you doing with the vision? Because we see that John was given a vision. John wrote his vision down. John wrote the vision down. And so we have to write what God is saying to us. We have to write the dreams down. We have to write the visions down. And I know Apostle told me a couple of years ago, she said, you need to get that dream book. She said, you need to get that book. And I got it out of obedience. I listened and I was obedient because God, when he's dealing with me with dreams and with visions, sometimes I don't always understand what they mean. And so I have something to help me. And so being obedient to the men and women of God that he has placed in our lives to help us through our Christian walk. And so I just want to really be encouraging on tonight. And I don't have much more to say, but I'd asked Rondell, as we was talking about this earlier this evening, I said, what would happen if someone who did not like us, didn't like being around us, didn't like the sound of our voice, don't like the color of our skin, don't like that we're short, don't like that we're tall, just don't like us. What are the chances that they would go out of their way to help us? Think about that. People that don't like you, what are the chances that they're going to go out of their way to help you? That they're going to help you accomplish your goals, whether it's going to college, starting a business, going forth in ministry. How are they really going to help you? Now, when you look at what God did through the book of Revelation, he loves us so much. He said, I am not going to allow you to be lost and not know what to expect because the time is near. And I said, okay, God. I said, I like that. You giving us a blueprint. And so at the end of the day, we don't have an excuse not to be ready. You hear a lot of people say, oh, I'm gonna get saved when I get myself together. The time is near. And if you could get yourself together, you would already be together and you would be on fire for God. But a lot of times we make excuses. I'm guilty of making excuses that I, you know, my this job that I'm on, or, you know, I got this going on, or I'm so tired. Well, then I probably need to check with God about how much I got on my plate, because time is still going to be ticking. And even though the book of Revelation is, you know, some people look at Revelation as being filled with doom and gloom. And for some people, that is true for them. They probably won't. You won't hear many people preaching or teaching a good Bible study, vacation Bible school from the book of Revelation. It's probably not going to happen, right? Because people are just like, well, I don't want to know. All these bad things are going to happen. Wars and rumors and, you know, the dragons and things coming out of heads and all this stuff. But God loved us so much that he's saying, I reveal myself to one of my servants and gave him a testimony with the angel who was right there to be a witness. It don't get no better than that. It doesn't get any better than that. But I wanted to share what God revealed to me earlier today. I was sitting at work and I said, God, I don't understand. This time is near. I said, I don't understand it. And he said, I'll give it to you this way. He said, a lot of times we're getting caught up in what Revelation says versus in seeing and how it prepares us for this life and this time that we as individuals have on this earth. And you may say, well, Adia, how do you know that? Well, when I was studying, it said that John was at the end of his life. Thank you, God. He was at the end of his life, but yet he still received a visitation from an angel that showed him the vision that Jesus said, I need John to get this vision down. He was the only one left from the 12 at this time. I need John to write this vision. And so even though he was near the end of his life at that time, God says, we can't focus so much on the doom and gloom and being scared about what's going to happen in the rapture and the seven seals and the seven churches and all of these things. He said, because the time is near for each and every one of us. And we don't know, if we don't know when Jesus is coming back, we surely don't know when our time is going to expire. He has not revealed that to us. And so he was just saying, he said, the time is near for all of us. And so that's where he gave me, what are you doing with the vision in God's time? Because the time is near for all of us. What has God shown you? What has God spoken into your life? What has been revealed to you through the word of God. Because at the end of the day, if I leave this earth and I have not done everything that God has called me to do, that is the end of my time. That is the end of my time. So I may not live to see revelations come to pass. I may not live to see it. But if the time is near for each of us as individuals, what are we doing with the vision in God's time? Because it's his time that he's given to us. We are on borrowed time. And so I just wanted to share that, that prophetic word that God gave to me is that, you know, don't worry about what is to come. God has just given us a blueprint. And just showing us the love, showing us his character, showing us his strength, showing us how much in everything that he is doing to protect us for what is to come. What we got to do is our part. We got to stay in covenant relationship with God. And so we see that Paul shares with the church of Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 2 through 5. He says, surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace, what was given to me for you. That is the mystery made knowing to be to me by revelation. As I have already written briefly in reading this, then you will be able to understand my insight and not my insight, not the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations. As it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. These verses were talking about the plan for the Gentiles being adopted into the body of Christ. And so we see throughout the Bible that God reveals to those who are saying, I'm here to do the work, God. I'll give up everything for you. I'll give up my family. I'll give up my job. I'll do whatever I got to do to be a kingdom citizen. Because I don't have a lot of time. None of us have a lot of time. And so when we have visions or the word of God is revealed to us, it is to understand that revelation brings understanding. When God reveals something to you, with it comes understanding. And so when we look at revelations, when we look at verse 3, of chapter 1, it said, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take heart to what is written in it, because the time is near. I went over to Revelations 22 and 6, and I think verse 10, it said, these words are trustworthy and true. God's words, the book of Revelations, is trustworthy. And it is true. And that's what the angel said to John. The Lord God, the God who inspires the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants the things that must soon take place. But what must soon take place in our time? What is taking place right now, today, that we are over, that we are supposed to take authority over? What are we supposed to do? Is it the school? Is it the nonprofit? Is it the feeding ministry? Is it just being able to take somebody from point A to point B? Is it story time at a local school so that we can read to children? What is it? Is it just dropping off a little magnet that said God loves you to the people that work in a post office or at the hospital where people work in third shift and sometimes they can't even get up and go to church the next morning? What's inspiring us? What is God inspiring in us? Verse 10 says, the angel says, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this scroll, because the time is near. So we don't have time to say, oh, gotta go. Let me put my Bible up. Up, time to clock out. He said, let the one who does wrong continue to do wrong. There's going to be some people that's going to continue to do wrong. He said, let the vile, that word means those that are extremely unpleasant. let the extremely unpleasant person continue to be extremely unpleasant. We're not gonna make everybody happy. And this is in the book. He says, but let the one who does right continue to do right. Even when people ain't doing right by you, continue to do right. Why? Because there's a blessing in it. It says, and let the holy person continue to be holy. Your time is now for what God has revealed, the vision, the dreams that he has given you. God has given us time to do what he has called us to do. But saints, friends, brothers and sisters, family, the time is still near. The time is still near. So I'm going to leave you with a challenge question. What are you doing with the vision in God's time? Y'all pray my strength in the Lord.
My God, listen, you know, as I'm listening to Elder Adia talk, man, I'm telling you, he's all in the Kool-Aid. And you see, this thing here with time, a lot of people have not really recognized what God is saying to them. That's the issue. And I'm glad that I love your title. What are you doing with the vision in God's time? I also want to commend Evangelist Marlette, because I'm just now seeing the text she sent me. And this is how the enemy don't even want her to get the information. But look, she said, Apostle, my tablet's not working. Can you text me the phone number and the access code and the password? I didn't even see this, but you know what? She found a way to be obedient, to be on time, so she can at least hear this word, so the enemy can't stop her from being nourished. Hallelujah. You know, the rapture. They're talking. I've noticed also on social media how all of a sudden they're preparing everybody for the rapture with the so-called an alien invasion. I started laughing. Yes, that's how they did this. You know what I mean? Because they know it's coming. Time is running out. You know, I like what you said. Revelation brings understanding. I like this whole piece. And the thing is, we're accountable. People understand it. Everybody is accountable to do your assignment, no matter what it is, you know, because there's going to be some people that because we're remnant and God is preparing us to help the rest of them come through. Remember, the remnant is that little small group. However amount's going to be left, we're the ones that's preparing and they have to help the people. And indeed, I thank you for letting God use you. Yeah, that was a hit and quit and right to the point. Yeah, what are you doing with the vision in God's time? Amen. Comments, open up. Let's go.
It's Marlette. Adia, thank you for your words. I have a few notes here. I didn't know that Revelations was written by John. That's John the Baptist, correct?
No.
It's not? Mm-mm. But which John is it?
Go ahead, tell him. Open up, everybody. Don't let me always be the teacher.
The Apostle
John. This was
John,
one of his apostles.
Apostle? Okay.
That Bible the Bible dictionary that I have that's there, open it up.
Yes.
And it'll tell you the history and who and everything else, okay?
Okay.
Okay, go ahead.
And okay. And I'm what is it? If we don't know where Jesus came back, if we don't know when Jesus came back, how do we know I believe it's where we're gonna come back or go up. I like that. And then it says, we have to stay in the covenant of God. That's real. I just enjoyed it all because it's an eye-opener for me. If Apostle hadn't told you, you know, I wasn't feeling well and I didn't write on time. But through the way that I look at it right now is that God wanted me to have ears to hear because I'm coming mm-hmm. across a lot of things that are enlightening my spirit and lifting me up. So I'm just going to thank everyone for their word and their wisdom that they have and the sharing of it. Thank you.
Amen. Listen, Evangelist, you'll be there soon too. That's why you come to the table and eat. The portion you can get, chew it, come back, ask questions. You know what I mean? Because you the, I said, yeah, you, no, we'll have another baby that's in here. I got two. I have another one that's new on there. That's the, so y'all the babies. Now you went to, now you're walking with your big sisters and brothers. And yeah, and we're grateful that you're sitting, that you're giving up your time. You didn't have to come here. You could have just done something else. But you have a thirst for this, and that's what it's about. And you want to know, and that's what it's about. But like I said, I see you moving through that nursing home with the anointing. All I give you, anointing and praying over people. On the mission field, go hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Evangelist. Next comment.
I was having some trouble with the volume. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. And it wouldn't have been no problem. You could have just told your wife to move on when you would have gotten the seat.
I just like, you know, the questions, you know, what are we doing with our vision? Because, you know, a lot of times we can get busy, you know, we can become complacent and, you know, and sleepy with our vision and not moving forward. And I think that's, you know, it makes it very simple to get out of alignment with what God has us to do. We just, you know, you get busy and just going and going and going. And then you're just like, okay, is this what God has me, you know, had for me to do? And he's the one that's giving me breath, you know? So I like that. The question that I had in mind was, are we being intentional? That's what came to mind. That's what the Holy Spirit spoke to me. Are we being intentional with our time? You know, and then with that intentionality, what does that look like? If I know I got to be somewhere at 9 o'clock, I'm probably going to leave around 8:30, depending on the traffic. So with that being said, you know, we got these periods of time that we not may not pay attention to. And I don't think the church, as well as, you know, those who are kind of on the fence with getting saved and giving their life to God, is paying attention to the time period that we in. You know, and so I thank God for that word. And then another question that came to mind was, what has God shown you? Mm-hmm. And then what is he trying to uncover? Because a lot of times when God is showing us things, he's trying to uncover something. And so And that's what patience is about. He's uncovering. It's a time where he's uncovering. He's exposing. Some people are going to be exposed for the things that they say they
did.
You know, vice versa. So, you know, it's that time of exposition. It's that time where he can, you know, kind of unfold his, you know, kind of see what's been really going on. And that's what it's going to be with the body of Christ. You know, people will be exposed, some good, some bad. You know, I just pray that people begin to change and you know, and really just go for God. I mean, that's where all our breath come from. That's where everything, you know, so if we're not going for God, if we're not focusing on God and being intentional, it's very get thrown off and be off kilter. And you're trying to figure out like why my body don't feel like it's in balance, my mind don't feel like it's in balance. So I appreciate that word the Elder Terry gave tonight.
Amen. Aileen, comment, then Sunny, then I'm gonna get Vivi. I know she's on there. Go ahead, Aileen.
Thank you. Elder Adia, I tell you, the time is near. What are you doing with the vision in God's time or in God's time? Definitely, I thank you how you talk about the book of Revelation, because you don't hear much about it unless you go on YouTube and hear a teaching of it. But I thank you how you mentioned that Revelation is the heart of God and how much he loves us. Most people, I hate to say, they want to stay away from that book. They figure it's scary and spooky and no, we're not going to touch it, but it's there. It's all 66 in the book of the Bible. You cannot just like, okay, let's do 65 and not do Revelation. It's there for a reason. And of course, you know, things were revealed to John, which is the disciple of Jesus. Also, I like how you talked about write the vision or dreams down. Revelation brings understanding, and your time is now. And I like how your husband said that we are being intentional with our time. I tell you, it just so insightful, and I sensed your heartbeat and your passion. I mean, it's not so much the tears, because the tears are real, because you're right, the time is now. I'm sitting here like, okay, I think people are going into my message at some point. At this point, it's like, you know, Apostle Helois, let's pass the collection plate, because I think if everybody is on time, what they're going to talk about, I may not have to talk about what I need to talk about. But I tell you, Adia, it was an on-time word. I'm definitely glad that you and your husband made it safe. Safely in Kentucky, but I'm telling you, you're there for a reason, not so much what's going on in the state of Kentucky, which I know I'm hearing about it, but definitely you're there for a reason. So again, thank you about the time is near.
Amen. Sunny?
Sorry, I was late, everyone. But Elder Adia, you hit it out the park once again. And there was a couple of key things that really confirm what the Lord gave me. You mentioned about the authentic witness. Now, you could have a false witness, but you mentioned about the authentic witness. And then you also said the blueprint and how time is near. I like what you mentioned. What are you doing with the vision? Like, we think we have all the time in the world. And when you said that time is expired, I thought of a video game. You remember the pinball games we used to play? And then when that quarter ran out, it said game over.
Yeah.
There was no more playing. And so it kind of, when you said that time, you know, time expired, that's what it kind of reminded me of. There's no more shooting of the balls. There's no more of the lights going on and off, flickering. Finito, game is over. So I'm just I'm grateful to what the Lord had given you for us. Thank you so much.
Amen. V, unmute yourself if you have a comment.
Good evening, everyone.
Hey there.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So I'm sitting here. And I enjoyed the word that was brought. And everyone had so many positive things to say, which was very encouraging to me, because right now I'm going through a transition. And everybody is speaking about how they are making time to speak with God and get in God's presence. And at that time, at some point, that was me. And something happened where I just, you know, I thank God in the morning and I just go about my day, and I should be in his presence more, looking to take the time that he's given me to be in his presence. And sometimes we don't do that because of family issues, you know, work or whatever. And it really shouldn't be no excuse, because he takes the time to wake each and every one of us up each morning and give us our health and our strength to put us in our right mind. So when Elder was speaking about time, I'm saying I take my time and I don't put my time where it should be. I'm putting my time all over the place and I'm sitting here feeling bad, but I know that wasn't the purpose of the word to make me feel bad. It's just letting me know that I have to pull myself up, get myself together, and get back in the presence of God, because I might not have too much time to do what he needed me to do. So I'm thankful for this word that was brought today. And I'm thankful for the new people that are on the line, and each of you expressed it differently. And it just sums up the time God is giving you is for him. It's not for what you want it to be. It's for what God wants you to make use of. So I thank each and every one of you for bringing the word about time.
Thank you, V. That's our newest one on the boot camp, the newest baby.